Varmt välkomna tillbaka till ett soligt Stockholm och här på Småbolagsdagarna. Vi är tillbaka efter en paus här nu med ny energi och först ut på scen har vi Alligator Bioscience och deras CEO Søren Bregenholt. God förmiddag Søren.
God förmiddag. It's a pleasure being here.
Thank you. I leave the stage and yeah, the stage is yours.
Yes, thank you and good morning. I'm Søren Bregenholt. I'm the CEO of Alligator Bioscience. At Alligator Bioscience, we develop tumor-selective immune therapies that are designed to specifically activate the immune response in the tumor and not elsewhere in the body. Therefore, our second-generation immune therapies combine maximal therapeutic efficacy with minimal toxicity, thereby differentiating from the first generation of immune therapies that are currently on the market today. So if I could have the next slide. A brief look at our forward-looking statements. Next slide, please. So let's start with a brief overview over Alligator Bioscience. We have a full clinical and preclinical pipeline. Today, I'm going to speak about our two lead clinical development products, mitazalimab, a CD40 agonist, and ATOR-1017, a 4-1BB agonist.
Kan man få det högre?
Pardon? Okay, I thought I heard a question. Ah. So these two antibodies each address key immune activation pathways that really sort of enhances the immune response to human cancers. And both programs comes with enormous medical and commercial potential and come with strong preclinical and clinical data packages supporting the first in class or best in class potential in their respective indications. And as I just said, we are on the way to move both of these projects into phase two clinical development this year. The company also have a strong innovation track record, having brought more than five products all the way from discovery into clinical development, both based on our proprietary breakthrough platforms, but not the least on our strong in-house drug research and development capabilities. As a reflection of this innovation capacity, we have recently developed a third generation immune therapy contract called NeoX-Prime. NeoX-Prime is a more patient-specific third-generation immune therapy. I will not speak about the NeoX-Prime today, but just lead your attention to the recently announced collaboration with U.S. biotech MacroGenics, really validating the technology platform as a future driver of immune oncology therapies in serious human cancers. Next slide, please. So, as I said, Alligator is an immune oncology company, and we focus on developing drugs that address significant medical needs in human cancers. Over the last decade, drugs like checkpoint inhibitors have really changed the cancer treatment paradigm and have helped millions of patients globally. Although these first-generation immune therapies are very effective, still only 1 to 2 out of five patients respond in a satisfactory way, leading to sufficient disease control. At Alligator, our goal is to increase this response rate by developing second-generation drugs with high efficacy and low toxicity to facilitate combination therapy with checkpoint inhibitors and chemotherapy and other standards of care. As already mentioned, we are exploring two candidate drugs within key immune pathways, and they are both entering phase two clinical trials this year, which is of course a very important inflection point for Alligator Bioscience, as positive phase two data naturally will increase the probability of bringing these drugs all the way to the patients. we have an aspiration to bring these molecules all the way through development ourselves, but we are of course also in dialogue with potential co-development partners and licensees of these programs. Next slide, please. So let's first talk about 1017, which is an antibody against the 4-1BB protein on T cells, the cell type that is important for eliminating the tumor cells within the tumor and eventually eradicate the cancer in the patients. So the target 4-1BB has at the recent ASCO and previous meetings seen emerging clinical validation, and we are very encouraged by the data that I'm going to show you, and generally the target as an important immune regulatory target in general. So 1017 is tumor selective antibody that activates T cells in the tumor and has a significant potential to work in synergy with checkpoint inhibitors like PD-1s. And you can say that in terms of mechanism, that where PD-1 sort of releases the brake of the immune system, 1017 pushes the gas, giving rise to a very strong immune response. It's of course important that when you have a strong immune response that you target this to the tumor and not elsewhere in the body. And I will show you data in a little while reflecting that point. So 1017 is now in late phase one clinical development, and we presented data from the ASCO conference only last week. And the current intention here is to start a phase two clinical trial potentially in gastric cancer towards the second half of 2021, with the potential to read out clinical efficacy already second half 2022. Next slide, please. So talking about efficacy and toxicity profiles, it's very important that you hit the right balance, being able to effectively kill the tumor while not have toxicity elsewhere in the body. This is important when the drug is given alone, but it's increasingly important when the drug is combined with other standards of care like PD-1s or chemotherapy. And the slide here illustrates the balance of 1017 in comparison with two competitor antibodies. Here on the left, you have urelumab from BMS, which is a very efficacious antibody, but also has an unfavorable toxicology profile that actually is dose limiting, only allowing 8 milligram flat dosing in the patients. On the right-hand side, you have an example from Pfizer, where the efficacy has been turned down out of the molecule, and you see an overcompensated molecule that is not efficacious at very high doses. And then in the middle, you see 1017, where we believe that with the safety switches that we have built into the molecule, we found a molecule with strong efficacy and a very favorable toxicity profile. Looking across the competitors and explaining a little bit about the efficacy safety profile of 1017, we can use this slide. As you can see, 1017 binds to the domain 2 of the 4-1BB molecule, which is the optimal place to bind because it gives the optimal activation, but it also prevents from what is called so-called super agonism and overactivation of the T cells. Then equally important, the T cell require binding in both end for activating T cells. And this is a feature that will not happen in the bloodstream, but only in the tumor, thus giving a very tumor selective and safe molecule, which have been demonstrated both in preclinical studies and also in our ongoing phase one study. So if we just turn to a couple of slides that we presented at ASCO last week, The first slide here is a so-called swimmer plot of the patients so far enrolled in the dose escalation phase one trial. And notably here, we can see that we are now dosing, have dosed at 200 milligram at the data cutoff point in at the end of March. And notably, we have so far observed patients, three patients with the confirmed stable disease, which is very encouraging at this early stage in drug development. Also, it's important to say that we did not reach what is called dose-limiting toxicities. That means that the adverse events or the adverse effects of the molecule were mild and not limiting. Importantly, we also looked at T-cell activation, so activation of the CD8 T-cells, those cells that when activated kills the tumor cell and eradicate the tumor. And basically what we can see here across three different parameters or biomarkers is that with the active doses of 1017, we have a strong activation of the CD8 component in the patients treated with these doses of the molecule. Combined with the absence of dose limiting toxicity, we are very encouraged by these data and will now continue the dose escalation of 1017 in this trial. So in summary, 1017 is in late phase one clinical trial. We have cleared a 200 milligram dose of the drug. We are continuing dose escalation. We saw only limited and no dose toxicities and no dose limiting toxicities. And we saw, as I just showed you on the previous slide, evidence of T cell activation. We are continuing dose escalation and expect to start the phase two clinical trials in gastric cancer towards the end of 2021. Now, having spoken about 1017 at T-cell activator, let's shift gears and talk about mitazalimab, our CD40 agonistic antibody. So CD40 is a molecule expressed on the antigen-presenting cells, the cells that are important for activating the T-cells that we just talked about. So again, here the idea is to increase the response rate in certain cancers where standard of care is either chemotherapy or checkpoint inhibitors. So when bound on antigen presenting cells, the CD40 antibody mitazalimab activates these cells, which allow them to activate attract tumor killing T cells that eventually will kill the tumor cells and eradicate the cancer. Our preclinical data supports a strong potential for the antibody to be combined both with PD-1, chemotherapy, and potentially also an emerging class of cancer vaccines. The molecule has been in phase one clinical trials in around 100 patients. And has presented itself with a very favorable safety package and also coming out with efficacy signals in that trial. And we are currently getting ready to start our phase two trial, Optimize One, in pancreatic cancer. This will happen in Q2, and we hope for a larger data readout in the second half of 2022. Next slide, please. So again, mitazalimab is designed for high efficacy and low toxicity using or exploiting the principles that I talked about before, including the need for cross-linking in the tumor. Number of molecules on the market, or not on the market, in the pipeline, and we are currently developing mitazalimab neck to neck with these molecules. Looking across these, next slide, please. Looking across these competitors, we are encouraged by the fact that the optimal efficacy safety profile of mitazalimab allows us to expose the patients to very high doses of the drug, thereby increasing the likelihood of therapeutic efficacy when we compare to some of the competitors that are listed on this slide. So next slide talks about the clinical development of mitazalimab in pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer is a indication with very, very high medical need. We see approximately 100,000 patients every year in the US and Europe combined. We see approximately 40,000 deaths each year. The median survival time is approximately 5 months, and you have a 5-year survival of only 10%. So there is a strong and significant medical need. We believe that the positive phase 2 data will provide a clear a regulatory pathway towards phase 3 and the market for the molecule, and of course the large market also talks about or sort of demonstrates a high market potential for the molecule. So recent data from some of our competitors have shown that the CD40 in combination with chemotherapy actually increases the 1-year overall survival rate of these patients. That is very encouraging. And equally encouraging is the biomarker studies from these trials showing that their CD40 molecule, both activated macrophages, dendritic cells, increased T-cell infiltration, and also had the positive effect on the tumor stromal. Now, given our optimal safety and efficacy profile of mitazalimab, Optimize One is designed with a more aggressive chemotherapy agent FOLFIRINOX, and we're also going to dose higher doses and more frequent than was recently described by in the data that I just described. And we believe that optimizes our probability of success in that trial, the probability of coming out with a positive phase 2 answer there. And if we just take a look at the Optimize One trial, you can see that we are starting with a safety run-in, testing two doses of the molecule in combination with FOLFIRINOX, and then we will continue. Once we have established the phase 2 dose from those two cohorts, we will establish into the main phase 2 part of that study. We expect to read out data from the two initial cohorts by the end of the year, and then a larger data readout towards the end of 2022. So coming to the end here, it's exciting times for Alligator Bioscience. The pipeline is strong and deep. Today we have focused on two molecules, 1017 and mitazalimab. 1017, we just presented data showing good safety, strong efficacy signals. And we're continuing dose escalation in our phase 1 trial there and continuing phase 2 preparation. And for mitazalimab, our CD40 agonist, we are getting ready to initiate phase 2 clinical trials in pancreatic cancer. And then we have, a number of other preclinical candidates that we look forward to be sharing news on later in the year. So thanks a lot for your attention. It's been a pleasure, and I'm available for any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much, Søren. You can hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Perfect.
I hope you could hear what I said.
Yes, we can, definitely, no problem. Alligator has been in the game for a long time now, and with some success and some drawbacks, now it feels like it's standing on fresh legs here with the new CEO. Could you give us your take on why this change this time is the best time to do these changes and looking forward with you as a CEO?
I think giving a sort of historic perspectives is probably not appropriate for me, but I can tell you what has attracted me to Alligator and a little bit of my view on the future. So first of all, immune oncology is exciting. It's very competitive, but there really is the potential here to develop drugs that can make real changes in patients' lives. And I think everybody working in biotech and pharma have to have that sort of passion to go to work every day to make that difference. Then Alligator, you're right. The company has been around. I think we have 20-year birthday this year, which we will celebrate. And I think I come into the company at a very exciting times with mitazalimab and 1017 sort of being at key points in the development. And agonistic antibodies have sort of seen a new rise here. The first generation was sort of limited by toxicities, but I think Alligator and others have sort of cracked that knot, now sort of giving a rise to antibodies with the right efficacy safety profile. So that's very important, and I'm really looking very much forward to push these molecules forward together with the excellent team here and all our collaborators. Then if you look a little bit back in the pipeline, our technology NeoX Prime, which sort of builds on CD40 stimulation of antigen-presenting cells, while at the same time bringing tumor-specific antigens to these to really sort of boot up the immune system in a patient-specific way, I believe that bispecific concept is really, really interesting. And I'm really looking forward to bring that forward on our own molecules and also in collaboration with partners like MacroGenics. So I think we have a good mix of pipeline, of technology, and a very competent team here. So that's sort of what brought me here.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. And could you give your take also on which projects you have there that you think have the best potential future value?
I think if you look at it from a single project perspective, bringing mitazalimab into phase 2 in pancreatic cancer, and we're currently looking at a second indication for that molecule. That will, of course, be the front runner of company value in the midterm, definitely. 1017 is also a strong candidate. It's a little bit behind. It's maybe a little bit more competitive, but the data that we just presented sort of really shows that there is future value in that molecule. And then on the mid to longer term perspective, I think NeoX Prime could be a fantastic addition to the treatment paradigm in solid tumors, where you can really sort of home in the therapy to tumor types that express the antigen that we really want to target.
To have these studies, I'm thinking about CD40 now, and potential 1015. Do you have any plans and ideas on what you're looking for in a potential partner there, or how do you looking to finance and do this?
You're absolutely. That's a good question. Biotech or drug development is expensive, needless to say. And my take and the company's take is that we have to have the ambition and the capacity, both sort of skill-wise, organization-wise, and also financially, to bring these molecules as far along the development value chain as possible. We need to do that with through capital raises, as you say, but we're definitely also looking for a partner to one of the programs. And I would really love to be working with a company that can take a sort of a, if not a leading role, then a co-leading role in developing one of these molecules together with us, and also not only to do one or two clinical trials, but really do a major clinical program to on the longer term maximize the value of either of those two leading programs.
And like the CD40 project, like as I said before, and you also acknowledged that you have been around for a long time. Like if you can looking very ahead in the future, like when can you actually hoping to reach a market with your products?
I think it's a fair question. I think we have a couple of years of phase two development in pancreatic cancer and then phase three. So you can add up the numbers there. I think what we are looking for in a second indication, and we're just doing the analysis now, so it's too early to sort of pinpoint specific indications, but looking for something more niche indication where we can move through phase two to phase three development a little bit faster than we are currently planning with pancreatic cancer.
And you have a lot on your table here this year and this following 12 months. What are your hopes to tell the potential investors and current investors that you will be able to present within 12 months from now?
Within 12 months, it's an unfair date because it sort of falls in the middle of next year, where we will have been. Within the next 12 months, we will initiate phase two with the CD40 in mitazalimab in pancreatic cancer. Potentially be ready to start a second indication phase two trial. We will have presented the full readout of the 1017 trial that we currently discussed today, and having started phase two, and then we will have initiated phase one clinical trials with Aptevo on our 4-1BB 5T4 bispecific antibody, where we're just in the process of getting ready for that phase one clinical trial. And then hopefully I've had the opportunity to present, or my team to present, exciting data on some of the programs on the NeoX Prime molecules, either our own proprietary programs or the program with Macrogenix. And then I will have hoped to be able to raise money to continue the development of these proprietary programs.
All right. So the owners have exciting times ahead. No less to say. So Absolutely. Thank you very much, Søren.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
Och